Okay, thank you for being here today in the middle of July for this talk by James Woodward. James is a distinguished professor at the University of Pittsburgh in one of the most important centers in philosophy of science in the world. Jim before was at Caltech in California for several years. And he is the former president of the Philosophy of Science Association, which is the main international association in philosophy of science. And Jim has been interested in causation, causality in general, in the sciences, and especially in biology, psychology, and medicine. He's very interested in psychology, neuroscience, the structure of sciences, and is the author of this book, Making Things Happen, 2003, with a subtitle which is A Theory of Causal Explanation. This book got the Lakatos Prize that you all know in this room, and Jim has been working a lot with many important people in philosophy of science, in science as well. And he has he's the author of many important papers, one of which is called Causation in Biology, Stability, Specificity, and the Choice of Levels of Explanation in Biology and Philosophy in 2010. If you're interested in his talk, maybe you will also be interested in reading his paper. I'm extremely grateful Jim accepted to come. He had many problems with his flights. His luggage was lost. So we're very, very lucky. Yeah, he bought blue jeans in Bordeaux yesterday just to be decent today with us. So thank you so much, Jim, and thanks a lot for accepting to give this talk on causation in biology.
Thank you very much, Thomas, and thanks to all of you for coming. So this is a talk about causation. I'm going to try to suggest some possible biological applications of the idea. There are ideas that I'll be presenting. There, of course, is a very long philosophical tradition of thinking about causation, going back at least to Aristotle, David Hume, many other people. And it's a topic that continues to flourish in philosophy and philosophy of science today. Now, when we think about causation, there are two different projects that we might distinguish. One is the project of distinguishing between causation on the one hand and mere correlation or association on the other hand. If you ever have taken a statistics course, you'll be told very explicitly that causation is not correlation. So the statisticians distinguish between the two very sharply. But then the statisticians typically will go on to discuss only correlation, and they won't tell you what causation is or what distinguishes it from causation. And that's one of the topics that I want to talk briefly about today. But I also want to do the following. Even if we make a distinction between relationships that are causal according to some kind of minimal criterion of causation, and those that are merely correlational, there are further distinctions we can make among causal relationships. And that's another aspect, the primary aspect that I'm going to be talking about in this talk. And a number of these distinctions, I hope at least you will recognize as being of some biological significance. So here are a couple of the distinctions among causal relationships that I'm going to be talking about. So in other words, the idea is that these are criteria or conditions that causal relationships can satisfy to different degrees. Causal relationships can differ in how stable they are. Roughly what that means is, would the relationship continue to hold as we change various other things in the background? I'm going to call that stability, or sometimes non-contingency of association. There's a condition that may be less familiar to you, but I think is intimately bound up with issues about the choice of levels of explanation. This is this notion of proportionality. It's roughly the idea that the cause and the effect should fit together in the appropriate sort of way, that the cause should contain as much detail as is necessary to account for the effect, but no irrelevant detail. This is an idea that the philosopher Steve Gavlo has particularly talked about. And then there's the notion of causal specificity, which is a notion that is all over biology, although I think it's not always entirely clear just what this notion means. And I'll be talking a little bit about what that might mean as well. Okay, so let me begin with the first project, which has to do with distinguishing between causation and mere correlation. And I'm going to be briefly describing a view that I'm attracted to and have defended. This is a so-called interventionist, or sometimes called manipulationist, view of causation. The basic idea is very commonsensical, I hope. In fact, it's so commonsensical that you might think it's trivial or nearly trivial, but I think it's not actually at all. The basic idea here, behind the interventionist account, is that causal relationships are relationships that are potentially exploitable for purposes of manipulation and control. So in other words, the idea is if you intervene in the right way to change or wiggle the cause, the effect will change too. And a merely correlational relationship doesn't have this feature. So causal relationships, what distinguishes causation from correlation is that the causal relationships are those that will support manipulation. So to take a very trivial example, going to the doctor is presumably correlated with being ill, but going to the doctor or staying away from a doctor is not a way of changing or manipulating whether you're sick or not. And it's exactly that distinction between a relationship that you can use to change or manipulate things and one that you can't that I think coincides with the difference between causation and mere association. So here's an attempt to be a little bit more precise about what this means, manipulationist idea. This is sort of philosophy speak. I apologize for those of you who are not philosophers, but the basic idea is you think of the relation, the relata, the things that are related in the causal relationship as variables that can take different values, and then the idea is that X causes Y if, when you intervene on X in the right way, Y will change. Now, what does this notion of intervention amount to? Well, you can think of it heuristically as a kind of idealized experimental manipulation. And a little bit more detail, the idea is an intervention on a variable X with respect to a second variable Y involves changing X in such a way that only the only changes in Y that might occur, if any changes in Y occur, are going to occur through the change in X. Or to put it a little bit differently, the change in X is a sort of exogenous change that comes from outside the system, which is such that it's kind of another way of thinking about it is it's unconfounded from the point of view of causal inference. It's the change in X with respect to Y is going to be independent of whatever other causes of Y may be operative. So that's the basic idea. Here's a simple illustration. As some of you may know, the very famous statistician, Sir Ronald Fisher, at one point suggested the possibility that maybe there was a common genetic factor that influenced both your tendency to smoke and your tendency to develop lung cancer. So his picture, in other words, was that the relationship between smoking and lung cancer looked something like this. A G is the gene in question that causes smoking and it causes lung cancer, but there's no relationship, Fisher was suggesting, between smoking and lung cancer. They're correlated, but there's no causal relationship. Now, how does this relate to the notion of an intervention? Well, an intervention on S here with respect to lung cancer would be an exogenous change in S that changes S independently of the other causes of lung cancer, such as G. It's the sort of thing that might be accomplished by a randomized experiment in which we try to induce people to smoke or prevent them from smoking. But of course, this would be unethical. But the intuition you're supposed to have is if you were actually to do this experiment, to manipulate whether or not people, on Fisher's picture of things, if there's really no causal relationship between S and L, if you manipulate whether people smoke independently of the putative gene G, then there should be no change in whether or not they develop lung cancer. So that's the intuition behind the interventionist view of things. So the idea is something like this: if you intervene on S here, the smoking variable, then what it'll do is change whether or not you smoke independently of whether or not you have the gene G. And the thought is that under this intervention, the correlation between S and L will disappear. So the mark of a merely correlational relationship is that when you intervene on the putative cause variable, the correlation between the cause variable and the effect variable disappears. Now, of course, Fisher was wrong about the causation of lung cancer, but I've just introduced this to kind of give you an example of a simple case in which this framework allows you to distinguish between causation and mere correlation. If, by contrast, we were able to, supposing Fisher's position, the view of the matter was correct, and there really was this sort of common cause structure that accounted for the correlation between smoking and lung cancer, then if you could intervene in some way to manipulate the gene, this would change both whether or not you smoke and whether or not you get lung cancer. So the suggestion here is one of the things that this interventionist picture does is it makes the connection between causation and experimentation, I think, particularly clear, and it also helps to make it clear why experiments, including particular randomized experiments, are a very good way of learning about causal relationships. The connection between causation and experimentation is built right into the interventionist approach. But that doesn't mean, of course, that you can only learn about causal relationships by doing experiments. You can sometimes, although it's more difficult, you can learn about causal relationships from non-experimental or purely observational data as well. And within this interventionist framework, when you're trying to learn about whether or not a causal relationship is present from purely observational data, what you're trying to do is to learn from the observational data what would happen if you were to perform some appropriate experiment. So this gives you a way of thinking about what you're trying to do when you engage in causal inference from non-experimental data. You're trying to predict the result of a hypothetical experiment. And in fact, yeah.
Yeah, just a question. Is it the counterfactual theory?
Yes.
Yeah.
Very good. I was going to come to that in a minute. Yeah, so let me just anticipate that. So in the case of a non-experimental observation, and you're trying to make a causal inference from it, what you're basically trying to do is to answer a counterfactual question. And a counterfactual is a conditional statement, an if-then statement, which refers in the first part of the statement to some possibility that might not be actual. So if I were to drop this phone, it would fall to the ground, and I don't drop the phone, that's a counterfactual, because the first part, the part governed by the if clause, is not it isn't actually true in that situation. Nonetheless, it seems as though we can talk about what would happen if we were to perform that experiment. So this is also a view that ties causal claims very closely to counterfactuals. And in fact, there's if you know anything about recent developments in statistics, and including biostatistics and econometrics, This is closely bound up with ideas about instrumental variables and regression discontinuity techniques, Mendelian randomization within biology. These are all ways of trying to get at what would happen if you were to perform an experiment without actually doing the experiment. So the claim is that this criterion M that I put up a little while ago, which is basically just the idea that the test for whether a relationship is causal is whether it supports manipulations in the way that I described. I'm claiming that that yields a distinction between causation and mere correlation. Now, I come now to counterfactuals. This condition M that I set out, just it's very, very weak. It just says that X causes Y. If you were to intervene on X in some appropriate way, Y would change. But of course, often you want to know a whole lot more about the relationship between X and Y than just that. You want to know exactly how Y would change under interventions on X. I mean, ideally, you might want to know what the functional relationship is between X and Y, if there is such a relationship. You want to know under what background circumstances that relationship between X and Y would continue to hold. And all of this can be spelled out in terms of interventionist counterfactuals, that is just counterfactuals that describe what would happen to Y if you would perform various interventions on X. Okay, so this then suggests the possibility that you can have a bunch of different relationships that in some sense satisfy the relationship M, but they might differ in other ways. For example, that you might have a functional relationship between X and Y that supports interventions, but maybe it's very unstable in the sense that if you change various things in the background, that relationship will break down. And that's the idea that I'll be talking about next. But first I want to say just a few words about the notion of explanation. Obviously, there's a close connection between explanation and causation. There's a lot of disagreement in the philosophical literature about whether all explanations are causal, but I take it nobody seriously doubts that one good way of explaining something is to cite its causes. And that's basically the way I'm going to be thinking about explanation. Just to say a little bit more about this, here's a way of kind of putting the basic interventionist idea in a slightly different way that connects it to explanation. Think about a good explanation as something that answers a bunch of what I'll call what if things had been different questions about the thing it is that you're trying to explain. So philosophers have this vocabulary for talking about explanation. There's the explanandum, which is the thing that you're trying to explain, the thing you ought to explain, if you're thinking about it in terms of the Latin, and then the thing that does the explaining, that's the explanans. And basically the picture is one in which what you want in a good explanation is that the factors cited in the thing that's doing the explaining, the explanans, are such that if you change them in various ways, there will be changes in the thing it is that you're trying to explain. And the thought is that to the extent that you can satisfy this, this kind of condition that I just described, you're going to have a better explanation. So what you want in a good causal explanation is that you have patterns of dependency showing how the thing you're trying to explain depends on the thing that does the explaining, where patterns of dependency are just these interventionist counterfactuals. You, of course, want the counterfactuals that your explanation cites all to be true. And furthermore, you'd like to leave as little out as possible. So you want a complete accounting of the conditions under which the explanandum will change as you can in terms of the explanans factor. So that's the way I'll be thinking about explanation. And I want to talk about some distinctions within causation. This is the second half of the project, so to speak. suppose that we have agreed, we have some sort of criterion, it might be the interventionist account, or it might be something else, that allows us to distinguish between causal relationships and mere relations of association or correlation. Then my claim is that among causal relationships, there are further distinctions that we can make, and it's these that I'm going to be talking about. And I'm going to talk first about the notion of stability, sometimes called non-contingency of association. Sometimes you hear people use words like invariance and so on to describe this. Basically, what this involves is the extent to which the relationship between the cause and the effect continues to hold as you change various sorts of background conditions. And that's the basic idea of stability. Let me just quickly mention, one of you raised, as we were walking over here, the question of how this relates to Bradford Hill's famous criteria, except I think he never used the word criteria for causation, but his view is often understood in that way. And certainly this stability thing is one of the things that Hill mentions, and so also is the notion of causal specificity. Hill is sometimes interpreted as claiming that these relationships, things like stability and specificity, are something like conditions for whether a causal relationship is present at all. I'm more inclined to see them as having to do with distinctions you can make among causal relationships. So causal relations can vary to the extent to which they're stable, specific, etc. So getting back to stability, here's a toy illustration coming from the philosophical literature. I'll give you some biological illustrations in a moment. This illustration is due to the philosopher David Lewis. Lewis imagines the following scenario. He writes a letter of recommendation for a job candidate. The letter of recommendation causes the job candidate to get a job that the candidate would not otherwise have got. As a result of that, getting that job, the job candidate meets his or her spouse, would not otherwise have met that person if he or she hadn't accepted the job. They get married, they have children, the children grow up and eventually die. So there's counterfactual dependence between the existence of the children and their eventual deaths and the Lewis writing the letter of recommendation. But as Lewis notes, we would find it rather odd, or in some way sort of inappropriate, to think that the letter of recommendation, writing the letter of recommendation, causes the existence of the children, or causes the death of the children. And Lewis's suggestion, translated into my language, is basically this is because that relationship of dependence between writing the letter and the existence of the children is very, very unstable. Change just about anything in the background. You know, so imagine that Lewis writes the letter of recommendation, but there's a somewhat stronger job candidate, some second person who gets the job instead. Then the relationship between writing the letter of recommendation and the existence of the children disappears. Imagine that our job candidate who gets the job had lingered a little less long in a certain bar where he met his future wife. Then no relation of dependence between the existence of the children and the writing of the letter. So that's an illustration of a highly unstable relationship. And the idea is that even when you have a relationship of dependence, counterfactual dependence between an effect and a cause, if it's highly unstable, we think there's something sort of unsatisfactory about the relationship. We prefer to find more stable relationships. Now, contrast that example with the following example. Suppose someone is shot through the heart at close range with a large caliber bullet. For some reason, philosophers always like to use these very violent examples to illustrate their claims about causation. Then I take it, and that's sort of, suppose the person shot in the heart and dies. In that sort of case, even if you had changed things in the background, as long as the changes were not too far-fetched or science fiction-like, the person still would have died. So the relationship between shooting someone through the heart with a large caliber bullet and the person dying is a relatively stable relationship. And that strikes us as a more satisfying example of a causal relationship. Okay, so that's the intuition. And here are a couple of examples which I picked out. So Richard Dawkins, some years ago, claimed that if there was a gene G, a variant of which G prime causes inability to read, then a G is a gene that causes reading. That strikes, I think, many people, many biologists, as somehow a problematic or less than fully satisfying causal claim. And the suggestion that I want to make is that's because the relationship between G and whether you can read is a highly unstable relationship. So it is true, if you imagine that that this gene exists and that there's a variant of it, such that if the variant is present, you will be unable to read. And, it is true that you have counterfactual dependence, at least in a society in which, you know, literacy is widespread, etc. You have counterfactual dependence between whether or not G or G prime is present and whether or not you can read, but it's counterfactual dependence of a highly unstable sort, because whether or not you learn to read is going to depend upon many other things besides the presence of G, even if you have G. It requires, of course, that you be in a culture which is literate. It requires that you receive some kind of education, et cetera, et cetera. So my suggestion is that this is an the reason why this suggestion that there's a gene for reading or a gene that causes reading strikes us as somehow inappropriate or not exactly perspicuous is that this is actually a case of a relationship that, although it involves a counterfactual dependency, is a highly unstable relationship. So contrast this with other kinds of cases, genes that cause, say, external sex characteristics. Here, the relationship of counterfactual dependence between possession of the gene and external sex characteristics is going to be more stable than, intuitively speaking, than the hypothetical relationship we were talking about between the presence of the gene G and whether or not you learn to read. And so in this sort of case, the use of causal language, the idea that there are genes that are genes for or genes that cause external sex characteristics or eye color, doesn't strike us as so problematic. So essentially this idea was used by Ken Kendler. Kendler is a fairly well-known psychiatric geneticist and very interested in the epidemiology, among other things, of psychiatric disorders. He labels this relationship that I've been calling stability, non-contingency of association. And what he does in this paper that I cite is he describes a number of criteria that he thinks are appropriate for talking about whether or not it's, there are criteria to tell you whether or not it's going to be appropriate to talk about a gene as a gene for a phenotypic trait. And he says one of the criteria that is relevant here is what I've been calling stability or non-contingency of association. And here's how he describes it. Non-contingent association means the relationship between gene X and disorder Y is not dependent on other factors, particularly exposure to a specific environment or the presence of other genes. So the to the extent that the relationship just depends upon, say, the presence of a single gene and the phenotypic trait, and it's stable under changes in the environment and changes elsewhere in the genome, then to that extent, the talk of gene four or gene causing the phenotypic trait is going to be appropriate. Kettler thinks that the satisfaction of this criterion, non-contingency of association, is, as he puts it, a classic, albeit not uniform, feature of genes that cause classical Mendelian disorders in humans. But he then goes on to say that it's characteristic of a whole lot of psychiatric disorders that he's interested in, that they tend not to be stable in this way, because whether or not you get an association between a particular gene, a dependence relation between a particular gene and the disorder depends upon a whole lot of other things instead. So the basic idea then is that the extent that a particular gene disorder relationship is dependent on or modulated by environmental events or the presence or absence of other genes, relationship in question is going to be relatively contingent, and then according to, or relatively non-stable, and according to that, it becomes less appropriate to describe the genes as genes for the disorder in question. So that's the first criterion, stability. So in other words, to put what I'm saying is that the reason why it's inappropriate or less than perspicuous to talk about a gene for reading is the same thing that makes us think that in David Lewis's example,